In this video, I'm going to show you the 7 quick steps to installing and constructing a biodigester. We are going to use the standard family size biodigester as a test case and install a simple on-site biodegradable waste biodigester. Step 1. Site selection and preparation. Select the site and location for biodigester construction. Site selection and location of biodigester is usually done after the site has been inspected and assessed. Preferably, this should be done in agreement with the plumber, who usually does the final connection, and of course, the homeowner. Siting of a biodigester should take into consideration both soil type and water table condition. Ideally, a biodigester should be sited in a well-drained location, typically with subsoils that are sandy, so that the digester can be placed totally and firmly in the ground. Siting of a biodigester should reflect the highest water table condition that one will find in the location and immediate surroundings of the biodigester. How do you determine this? By digging a hole and observing the saturation depth of the area you are going to work. When the water table during severe conditions is below 4 feet, the digester can be installed at full depth, even less than 1 foot exposed above the ground. If the water table is high, the site consideration determines that the digester should be lowered to the ground only a few inches. In this case, the front of the digester hole should be a few inches deep and the back of the digester hole should be 6 inches to 8 inches deeper than the other. Mark and dig ground based on size of biodigester to be installed. Mark and dig the ground based on the type of biodigester you intend to construct or install. For example, 2.5 feet width by 5.5 feet length for the standard family size biodigester. If you intend to need a bigger digester for a larger number of users, then by all means increase the size. But for the average Ghanaian family, the standard family size will do just fine. Let me add this quickly though. In locations that are not ideal, like waterlogged areas, the installer must place the digester at a depth so that it will never be below the water table, even during the raining or wet season. Step 3. Dig rectangular shaped digester bed hole in depth depending on required slope for plumber. Remember, after agreeing with the plumber for the location, we are also supposed to agree with the plumber for the depth which the digester must go. If the homeowner intends to do filling in the house, then obviously you are supposed to do the digester at an angle or at a depth whereby it will still show up a bit for the final floor, tiling or pavement blocks laid. So I will reiterate again, the type of digester to be installed will usually be determined by the number of users of the facility. So if it's a 3-bedroom house, 4-bedroom house, a 5-bedroom house, or even a bigger property. And also, the digester hole should be rectangular and big enough to hold at least a 2 feet by 5 feet digester. It's important the base of the digester hole should have a slight pitch towards the back of the hole, with the back end being about 6 to 8 inches deeper than the front end. Now to step 4, which is the soak hole construction. You will have to prepare a water drain area for soak pit, which is the soak hole construction. The soak hole, as we have determined for biodigesters, is a circular hole that is dug between the digester bed hole, right? A 4 feet long pipe or a 4 inches long pipe will connect the bottom back of the digester with the soak hole. Out of the back of the digester bed or the digester hole, you are required to dig a 2 to 3 feet long trench, which is wide enough to hold the leachate pipe, which is usually between 3 inches and 4 inches in diameter. I prefer you simply use the 4 inch pipe just to allow for enough wastewater to pass through, depending on the users as well. this hole should be as deep as a digester bed hole. Then at the other end of the trench hole, you dig a circular hole that can start from 2 to 3 feet in diameter, and that will serve as the soak hole. Now the depth of the soak hole or the bottom of the soak hole should be 2 feet, 6 inches below the bottom of the leachate pipe hole. I hope you get this one. Because you are going to do screeding inside the digester bed, the slope of the water will have to come out through the leachate pipe and then go into the soak away or the soak hole pit, right? So it means that the bottom of the soak hole pit will always be about 2 feet, 6 inches deeper to allow for enough gradient and slope for the water to come and go inside for the filtration to happen. Now, in terms of filling the soak hole, you will be required to fill the bottom of the soak hole with first a layer of large rocks. Each rock should be about 3 inches in diameter. And then you can also use broken blocks for filling the soak hole, since they also absorb water very well. There are some places when you go and then you are doing the digester, you will find it difficult taking along stones or you getting nice stones to fill the digester bed. So if there are broken blocks around, you can collect some of them and use it to fill the bottom of the soak hole. They also work well. And then filling the soak hole, remember, allows for easy penetration of the floater water. So when you're filling the soak hole, remember first large rocks, then cover the large rocks with a layer of smaller rocks. And then after the smaller rocks, you can, if there's some chippings, you can collect some of the chippings and then put them on top of the smaller rocks. Line the inside of the soak hole with a piece of recycled plastic. The plastic should cover the rocks and go up the sides of the hole slightly. The top lining ensures that rainwater does not seep into the soak hole to allow for easy penetration of the wastewater from the digester. On top of the plastic lining, then fill the soak hole with the same topsoil that you was dug out. And because the soak hole is buried, it's always preferable it's done such a way that nothing will come and block it, which will prevent the water from coming in as it is required. And if it's a large digester, you might need as much as 80 pieces of blocks. If it's precast slabs, you will just have to arrange them, use the binding wire that's already in the fabricated slabs, twist them and hold them firmly to hold the digester firmly together. And then you will use mortar to seal all the joints. And then in some cases, in terms of the screeding, you must do a screeding that will lead to the so-called pit where you have put the leachate pipe. In some cases, you will have to do the screeding and wait for it to dry well before leaving your blocks to support the digester bed. Step 6. Prepare and fill the digester bed with filtration material, which will be a multiple layers per instruction. So the digester bed, you will set it up with a wire mesh. Then it means that you lay the wire mesh across the blocks and cement other blocks into the place. There are some instances we use porous made of chippings and cement in place of the wire mesh. What happened with this was that most of the government projects, it was agreed that porous will last better than the wire mesh, because the wire mesh after a time, between 2 to 3 years, will corrode because of the acidic water coming from the digester. So then the porous chippings were a better option, and then most people now use the porous chippings in place of the wire mesh. You can also do that, but you can go back to the basics and still use your wire mesh, and then knowing that a bad digester, when done properly, will last you 2, 3, 4, or 5 years, and then maintenance work will have to be done, and then replacement of all the materials inside the digester bed will have to also be replaced. It means that then the wire mesh will work fine in any situation, right? So the next thing is to line the digester bed with 2 layers of fiber net or mosquito net. You place it directly on top of the wire mesh or the porous. Now you lay the sawdust, your hay or fiber. What we sometimes do is to add the sawdust, treated sawdust, and then we add the fiber, coconut fiber on top of it. So we add about 3 to 4 inches layer of hay or fiber or sawdust on top of the mosquito netting or the fiber netting. And then add coconut fiber to help aid the microorganisms in their biodegradation process. There are some cases you can add organic manure or compost if necessary. So with that, you add a 3 to 4 inches layer of rich compost or organically rich topsoil on top of the coconut fiber or the hay. The hay is usually the green grass that are cut and dried that the horses usually feed on. When they get that one, it works well because microorganisms can easily be generated from it and they will aid in the decomposition. Again, be sure to cover the entire bed, including all the top corners. And the last step, which is step 7, is to put the top slab and cover to seal the digester. In this case, you can also decide to put an inspection chamber and spacing chamber outlet if necessary. In some cases, when you have a problem or you are called to come and do maintenance or check if the digester is still working well, you don't want to go and break all the ceilings that you have done on the digester. So if you have a inspection chamber on top of the digester, you only open it up and look inside the digester if there's water inside or it's working well. It's not necessary to place a vent pipe on top of the digester. There's a video, I'll give the link up there, where you can see why you don't need a vent pipe on your biodigester. And then you can also make sure that the surrounding of the digester is filled to the desired level, allowing the homeowner or those who are working on the site to secure the digester, and then add landscaping to the digester area. So basically, this is what you do when you follow all these steps. Then your biodigester is done, and then you are in safe hands.